Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, host of Mean Lady Talking, and I wanted to give you a little explanation about today's podcast. Today's podcast, episode 22, is actually supposed to be from last Friday, and I recorded it, I uploaded it, and previewed it, distributed it, and it seems to have disappeared. So over the weekend, I was doing some video files, and I needed to make room in my computer, and there's really no reason to keep, or I thought there was no reason to keep, the old audio files, which take up a lot of room. So I deleted them all. And then Monday, I was getting ready to do Tuesday's podcast, and I couldn't find Friday's podcast. So I rushed to record it before I started Tuesday's podcast. In my rush, I didn't explain the letters that I received very well in the situations. So let me give you a little bit of an introduction before we go on to the podcast. The first person, when talking about revealing self to others, the first question was about having general anxiety disorder. So that one is fine, the way that it is recorded and explained. But the next ones are a little jumbled. So these are the situations. The first person was on a date, and the guy explained that he got into his last relationship before he had finished the relationship directly before that one. So in other words, he was telling her that he was at some point cheating on his girlfriend. He thought that they were just in a rough patch. And I say this on this podcast, but it's not really clear as to what his intentions were. He explained in a way, as cheaters often do, in that he didn't want to give up the opportunity to go with this new person who seemed really great, but he didn't want to give up on the old relationship because they had a really great relationship at one point. So he was hedging his bets. He was staying in the old relationship while starting the new relationship. And he told her this on the third date. And she just went full steam ahead. Now, the next one is about somebody who got caught cheating. And of course, she forgave him because she said that she was a nice person. And you, if you've followed me for any length of time, you know how I feel about, oh, but I'm a nice person. So I explained that. And then when he cheated again, surprise, surprise. Now, this is when they're in a relationship. And she's not the same person as the person who was told about the overlapping relationships in the other one, that you'll hear all about this. So he cheated, promised he never would again. Of course, promptly went out and cheated. Not overnight, but fairly soon. And her issue was that he didn't have any compassion for her. That's what she said. She said the thing that hurt the most, not that he cheated, not that he was with somebody else, but that he didn't seem to have any compassion for her and didn't seem to care about her feelings. If you are with a cheater, they're not going to care about your feelings. If they cared, they wouldn't cheat. So I go into that in the podcast. Okay, so then the next situation that I kind of roll up into is a friend of mine, two friends of mine started dating each other. And I knew my female friend had certain standards, or so she said, that even though you're not in a monogamous relationship yet, if you date other people, you don't sleep with them. And I left that part out of the story. So it seems like, why should anyone care that he went out with somebody and slept with them while he was seeing her? And I knew from being friends with both of them that they had talked about the situation. They had talked about, okay, we're free to date others, but we're not free to sleep with others. And one of the reasons was she was a very smart cookie, and taking a cue from me, she was waiting for the STD testing results. So the testing results are not really good. If you do the test, hang back to wait for them and then sleep with someone else. And I knew when he told me he had slept with somebody else and under what circumstances. And he lied to her about that night. But I knew that if she knew the truth, she would have been furious because they had agreed and it was a good agreement. We do our STD testing. We're free to date other people. We're moving toward a monogamous relationship if seeing each other keeps working out. We keep moving forward. But in the meantime, before we make our relationship a committed relationship, before we swear that we're not going to see anybody else, we're free to date other people. But because of the STD testing, we're not free to sleep with other people. And that was an agreement they came to together. And when they told me about this, I thought that she was the one I'd have to worry about more than him. So anyway, as I was editing the podcast, in my rush to get Fridays back there where it belonged, I smoothed over some of those letters and didn't fully explain them. So when I played it back and I was listening to it to do show notes and to do editing, I realized that it was very confusing. So this is the story, and this is a Friday podcast that's been rebooted since I don't know what happened to the other one. And if you have any questions, as always, please, please, please send them to meanladytalkingpodcast@gmail.com, and I will give you answers on an upcoming show. I apologize for the delay in getting this episode out there, and I hope that this introduction explains a little bit of what's going on in this podcast. So I hope that you get something out of the podcast, and if you have questions, comments, situations that you want to talk about, if you want to come on the podcast, please remember to write to me, and I hope that you enjoy today's show. Thanks so much, guys. Talk to you soon. And away we go.
Welcome to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast. This is the podcast that tackles tough questions about relationships, life, love, and loss. It may not be the advice you want, but it's probably the advice you need. And now here's your host, grief therapist, motivational speaker, relationship expert, best-selling author, and attorney, the not really mean lady herself, Susan J. Elliott.
Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, host of Mean Lady Talking, and this is a reboot of episode 22. Last Friday's podcast, for some reason, disappeared. Don't know where it went. I had uploaded it, previewed it, seemed to be fine, went to distribution channels, and never saw it again. So here we are again. I have been working on developing a boot camp for the aftermath of a breakup with the personality disorder, and I am very happy to announce that I am finally going to be able to roll it out. I'm not offering boot camps in 2019, and because I had a waiting list for both the codependency boot camp and the woman's boot camp early this year, I am going to do the codependency boot camp again in the fall, and I'm going to do the recovering from the aftermath of a breakup boot camp. This is a very special boot camp, and it will go 12 weeks. We'll have two breaks in there, not breaks where you'll be totally on your own, but I take 2 weeks to do one-on-ones with people in the group. I haven't yet announced it to my mailing list, so if you want to be a part of that, please, please, please send me email at meanladytalkingpodcast@gmail.com. And if you want to be part of the last codependency boot camp, please let me know. Just send me email to meanladytalkingpodcast@gmail.com. That would be terrific. So the first question had to do with standards of compatibility and revealing self to others. The woman who wrote asked me about mental illness, and I said to her, What mental illness are you talking about? And she said she has generalized anxiety disorder. Now, generalized anxiety disorder is not usually something that is going to rear its head in your relationship if you're taking medication for it, if you're going to therapy for it. I have anxiety, and I believe that as long as you have it under control and you don't use it as an excuse, then you should just be fine. And I wouldn't reveal that until you're on the verge of entering a committed relationship. As I've said before, you don't want the whole world knowing all of your business. So if you have any kind of recovery, any kind of treatment for anything, you don't really want to announce that on a first or second date. And I don't think that generalized anxiety disorder is a big deal. And, you know, there's probably some situations where you become more anxious than others and you might need to be talked down off the ledge, but the other person doesn't really need to understand anxiety. They really just need to understand how to soothe my partner. And that should be without saying in any relationship. If you're so anxious that it's becoming an issue in a relationship, then that's your problem and you really need to own it and do something about it. Either take medication, go to more therapy, work harder, or just realize that your partner is not responsible for always calming you down. You can't be running around like a crazy person, wringing your hands and yelling that you're anxious all the time, because nobody is going to want to babysit that. And I'm talking as a person who has anxiety disorder and has been with people with anxiety disorder. So you can't use anything that you're recovering from or anything that you have, any diagnosis, as an excuse to act out in a behavioral way. Though in some instances, you do have to explain to the person, my anxiety just goes off the charts when I'm first confronted with an issue, a problem, a situation. So I'd appreciate if you understand that, but I understand that, you know, my anxiety is my problem. I just need a little bit of soothing, a little bit of this, a little bit of that. It shouldn't be so out of bounds of a normal relationship. Everybody in a healthy relationship should be able to comfort and soothe the other. It just shouldn't be off the charts. Now, if there were, I would say that this also goes for depression and other things that are fairly common and on axis one. Again, if you tend to be depressed and you don't want to be on medication, you have to explain this to your partner, and you also have to make sure that you keep your depression under control. Therapy and medication, if you don't want to do medication. Again, you can't hand somebody your hurt or your anxiety or your depression and say, here, fix this. That's not what healthy relationships are all about. And you can absolutely have a disorder like depression or anxiety, even bipolar, and act like a perfectly normal human being in a relationship. It doesn't have to be a big issue. And it won't be a big issue unless you make it a big issue, or unless you're not compliant in your treatment of the issues. Now, if you've been diagnosed with borderline personality disorder, chances are you're under the care of a mental health professional, and chances are that you take medication, and you should reveal that to a partner before you get into a long-term relationship. If you've ever been psychiatrically hospitalized for something, you should tell people before you commit to a committed relationship. My late husband, Michael, was with a woman who she decided she wanted to get pregnant. She was bipolar with psychotic features. She went off of her medication to get pregnant. She never discussed any of this with him. She didn't discuss that she had bipolar disorder with psychotic features. She didn't discuss she wanted to get pregnant. And the next thing you knew, she's running around the house having full-blown delusions. Full-blown psychotic episodes. He had no idea what was going on. And even when her family, who knew this and kept it from him as well, they didn't explain it to her at all. They just let it all happen. And he was really left holding the bag. So something like that you really need to let people know about. Also, if you're going to try to get pregnant with somebody that you're not married to, you should probably tell them that too. But I really do believe that you have to guard yourself and your private information on the first few dates. You just don't want this information out there for everybody. You never know who knows who and who might know your boss. Or the next question that I have is, somebody who had asked questions in the beginning of a relationship, and the other person, he had actually told her that before he ended his second to last relationship, he had started his last relationship. And when she talked to him about it, he said that he thought that maybe him and his girlfriend, the one before last one, and he had just been having a bad stretch. So he started seeing this other woman and didn't really enter into a relationship with her until he realized that it was more than just a bad stretch in his relationship. They were on their second or third date, and he dropped this on her. And she, for reasons I can't even fathom, figured out how this wasn't a problem. She was very enamored of him after the first date. She felt very flattered when he asked for a second date. So on the third date, when he dropped this on her, she was already over the edge. Already over the edge. She figured out a way to rationalize it and justify it. I also had a friend of mine who was dating another friend of mine. This was weird. They met at my mother's funeral, and that's even weirder. But after he started seeing my friend, he went out with this young woman. We were probably in our early to mid-30s, and the woman that he dated while he was seeing my friend was about 21. And according to him, she was a beautiful nerd. He met her in the computer science lab. He was very taken with her. He knew that he was moving toward a committed relationship with my friend, but he wasn't there yet. And he dropped this in my lap, and I was furious, furious. I said, how dare you tell me this? You better tell her. You need to tell her. And I was just beside myself for a few weeks, and I kept saying to him, I'm not talking to you until you tell me that you told her. Well, then they went away one weekend. They decided they were going to be committed monogamous, and they slept together. And then lo and behold, after they slept together, he told her about the earlier incident with the 21-year-old. And she called me, and she was all understanding. Apparently, after lovemaking, within the glow of oxytocin, she was all fine and well with it. If you want to take unacceptable behavior and move it into the acceptable column just because you've made love with somebody, that is a foolish, foolish way of doing things. The cycle of self-deception, of denial, begins when someone says, I'm a cheater and a liar. And in those two instances that I just told you about, each time the person was saying, I'm a cheater and a liar. And each time the other person said, in their head, but not with me, right? Like a magic, they just changed. They didn't have an epiphany. They didn't have any huge revelation. They didn't go to therapy. They didn't go to Cheaters Anonymous. They didn't suddenly find religion and decide to reform. Nothing happened between the last bout of bad behavior and the new bout of bad behavior. And if nothing changes, nothing changes. But you, for some insane reason, with no basis in fact, want to believe that they will be true to you. And there's only one response to that, which is, oh my, oh jeez. No. When someone shows you who they are, believe them. When a person says, I am dishonest, your expectation is set. When a person says in his or her actions, I am dishonest, evasive, and non-committal, what part of you goes, oh, I want a piece of that? As I'm researching and working with clients and doing all the work that I'm doing for the upcoming boot camp, surviving the aftermath of a breakup with the personality disordered, I go into the early struggle that you could be trying to overcome from your past when you see the dishonesty and the inability to commit and you still say, I want that. Because you're not stupid. It's not like you're thinking, I do want someone who's a liar. But it's because you have unresolved stuff from the past going on, or you just want to believe the good stuff you're hearing and you discount the bad. It's splitting before you ever even get into a relationship. You should not be splitting. I mean, splitting is something that happens upon breakups, and the relationship inventory and getting past your breakup really pulls it together for you so you stop splitting. But you should not be splitting on a third date. And you should not be splitting post first coitus. One of my clients said to me when I asked her these questions, he was so charming and fun and attractive and social. Okay? There are many people who are charming, fun, attractive, and social that don't have, oh, by the way, I'm also a cheater and a liar. In fact, being a cheater and a liar makes one fatally unattractive, or it should make them fatally unattractive, unless you're attracted to lying and cheating. If it's a struggle you want to overcome, if there's some sort of unhealthy need of yours to get somebody who is a cheater and a liar to be faithful and committed to you, this is playing with fire. Because usually the lying liars and the cheating cheaters will come back with promises of fidelity, of truth and loyalty, and a whole bunch of other fairy tales. And why do you believe this? Why do you believe this from someone who has shown you no tendency to tell the truth, no tendency to be faithful, and hasn't done a single thing to change? I've even heard people say, well, I'm a nice person. I believe in giving second chances. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? As I have said a whole bunch of times, I'm a nice person. I believe in second chances translates to, well, I'm an idiot. There is a huge difference between being nice and being a fool. And putting up with lying liars and cheating cheaters does not make you nice. It makes you an idiot. Giving and giving and giving to someone who doesn't give back doesn't make you generous. It makes you a fool. Knowing that a person is unfaithful and expecting different behavior from them this time doesn't make you a nice person. It also doesn't make you a victim. It makes you a volunteer. So smarten the hell up. Because after the cheating cheater, lying liar, walks out the door, we're saying, wait, I was going to marry you. We were going to be together for a long time. Where are you going? And why did you want that? Why did you want to be together a long time with a cheater and a liar? What's in it for you? It's only more of the same. Why do you want to put a ring on that? Too many people have to deal with cheating after marriage when they've had no warning. Here you have warning and you want it anyway. Why? Another reason is, well, we have great chemistry. And as I've said, great chemistry is often just your dysfunction saying hello to someone else's dysfunction. Without honesty and trust, great chemistry is a bunch of hormonal blathering. It means nothing. It's the rush of the possibility of winning over the struggles of our past, of getting the cheater in line with fidelity, of getting the liar in line with the truth. And we all know that ain't happening. The great chemistry is the rush of roping someone in who doesn't want to be roped in. It's the idea of winning against all those other suitors who were vying for his attention. Oh, look, girls, I got him. What do you got? Nothing. You actually just let all the other fools off the hook. The world is full of fools. You can't swing a cat without hitting a bunch of people trying to be the one person a cheetah walks off into the sunset with. Guys punch each other out over this. Women key each other's cars over this. They're fools, one and all. In dysfunctional relationships, great chemistry is there because it's so unstable. It's like a roller coaster ride. It gives us great adrenaline while being whipped around turns and plunged down hills. And even as things are calm, we're clack, clack, clacking up a nice incline, enjoying the view. But our heart is pounding because we know we're about to be dropped like a stone as soon as we get to the top where the view is the best. Some people truly love roller coaster rides. They're addicted to them. But you can't live on the roller coaster. Eventually, you have to get sick of that and go home. Many people get into relationships knowing that the person is a liar and a cheater, or they continue our relationships when the person comes back swearing fidelity, swearing truth, justice in the American way. But you have advance warning and it's just going to happen again and again and stop kicking at the football Charlie Brown. You had a heads up and if you ignored it or you thought, not with me, I'm like the best. How did that work out for you? All that advance notice, all those neon lights, all those red flags, pink flags, yellow flags, orange flags, all the flashing blinking lights that said keep out, go away, retreat, run, and you plowed straight ahead. Many people who wind up with cheating cheaters or lying liars do so without knowing it in the beginning. If you have advance warning and chose to ignore it all or chose to go back after cheating happened, what more do you want? Do you know how many people would have loved that information and would have turned tail and run to avoid the broken heart they got from being with a cheater? But not you. You think, yay, I got me a cheating liar. Awesome. Awesome. Cheating liars don't care about cheating and lying. Their own self-worth is not high enough to give a damn that they are unfaithful banana heads. So why would they care about you? Why would they care about your self-esteem? They don't, as they trample all over it. They don't, and they won't, and they can't. Even if a person didn't cheat and lie, when someone wants out, they want out. They don't have to stand around feeling sorry for you. They just want to go. They don't give a rat's patootie about your self-esteem and your hurt feelings. The question you need to ask is, why go to the dry well for water? Why get blood from a turnip? Even if he cared about your self-esteem, even if he cared about your feelings, or even if he acted like he did, so what? Who cares? Consider the source. He's a lying liar, a cheating cheater. Who cares what he thinks about anything? What would a tender response do for you? Would it make you swoon and go, oh, I knew he loved me? Would it change things? Who cares what level of compassion a lying cheater would have for you? Do you think that making him feel bad would make you feel better? Why would it? It's worth nothing, nothing. Cheating liars keep you off your pins, and you allow it. You have to go back. You have to figure out from your life inventory, what are you getting from all this unsettledness? What are you getting for settling for the unsettledness? You have to do your journaling, your affirmations, your relationship, and your life inventory. Somewhere deep inside you is a struggle with someone else that has nothing to do with this person. In addition, you have huge self-esteem issues. Once a person cheats, bye-bye. Once a person admits to cheating recently, bye-bye. Period. End of story. If you think you can change it and cure it, good luck with that. I have a wall I'd like to sell you so you can beat your head against. It doesn't come with a pillow. This is not about the other person. This is about you. Don't be so enamored of someone that the first time they tell you about cheating or the first time they cheat, you're still sucked in. Cheating comes in, you go out. You have to make that commitment. You have to do the standards of compatibility inventory and getting back out there. You have to do those things. It's absolutely, absolutely, absolutely imperative. You cannot be a healthy person without boundaries, standards, and knowing what you can and cannot put up with in a relationship. And cheating should be on the not acceptable, not ever, not once. And if it is, you need to do something about that. You need to take a very, very long look at it. Your goal should be to have such high standards, to have such healthy boundaries, that if there's even a whiff of cheating or a whiff of a history of cheating, you're gone. You have to stop falling for people before you even get to know them. And if you spend a wonderful weekend with somebody and you're committed and you make love, and then this person says, oh yeah, while I was seeing you, I also like spent the night with a 21-year-old girl. Suck in the oxytocin, put on your pants, and go home. Because that relationship ended badly. Surprise, surprise. It ended really badly. And I hate being in a position to say to one of my friends, I told you so. And he and I are no longer friends. I mean, I just could not put up with it. He put me in a position that was absolutely untenable. Because if I knew that any other guy had done to her what he had done, I would have told her, like, outright. And he swore me to silence. It was a horrible position for me. And I was so angry, I lost sleep over it. I kept thinking, she's going to know that I know, and she's going to stop talking to me. But he played his cards the way a player does. And if you knew this guy, he was the biggest nerd. He had been in a very codependent marriage for a long time, where he was codependent and ran after this crazy wife of his for a long time. If you knew him, you would never think of him as a player. Never. He was this nerd. He was this guy from Central Ohio. He was a mathematics major at Brown University. He was an engineer. It was like he would be the last person you expect this silliness from. But I guess if you're a pretty young thing and you bat your eyelashes, you can get Mr. Nerd's play. And up until that excursion with the 21-year-old and then his his explanation to me about it, I actually had a lot of respect for him. And that went out the window. Out the window. When someone tells you who they are, believe them. If you're listening to somebody explain away their past cheating, especially if it's recently, or their overlapping relationship, and you're just going full steam ahead, something's wrong. And you need to check yourself, hang back, and reevaluate what's going on for you. So please look at the standards and compatibility inventory in getting back out there. Look at the life inventory in getting past your breakup. And as always, send your questions, comments, and stories to meanladytalkingpodcast@gmail.com. And if you want to sign up for one of the two new boot camps for the fall, please, please, please do so. Please send me email immediately. They sold out in record time for this summer. And I don't want to see anyone lose out because I'm not offering these in 2019. So truly appreciate you listening, guys. Please take care of yourself. And remember, you can do this. Take care, all. Bye-bye.